Welcome to the latest edition of the Wrestle Ropes podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined, my co-host for Fair City Wrestling preview shows. It's the man with the pencil himself. It's Kevin Williams. Welcome back.
Me. Hi.
Well, since the last time we spoke, it was two shows, so we thought, that's quite a packed weekend. Yeah. This time, three. So, you guys are
grey in the beard, Billy. Do you see the grey in it?
So you guys seem to be a glutton for punishment, it seems, with the old wrestling, and just going, you know what, two is easy. Let's get a third one in there.
Let's do three. Why not?
Why? It's probably a good place to start. Why three shows?
Pretty much, you know, like we always planned on going back to the Bonner Hall, especially after November's was such a success. And it just made sense to do that after we did a show in Perth. Again, we'll do our 2 days. But, you know, Tayport being what it was last time, it was such a massive success for Tayport, the Larrick Centre and the community. They were itching to have us back. So it just made sense. Did it make sense for someone's, you know, positive mental health? No, because no. But it makes sense for the FCW and the FCW brand and the FCW fan base. So, yeah, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, let's do it.
So we'll go into each show as we go along, because, of course, yep. For those that are keeping track of the announcements, either through Fair City Wrestling on Twitter or Facebook, or through ourselves at swnscotland.com. You'll know that there's a lot of matches in the first night and a trickle out because things may happen the first night that may conclude into the weekend's events. But we'll get into them in a moment. I apologise for anyone listening to the last two reviews, two things I've done in this room. It's quite a stuffy room, I've found. I know that big window there, if I open it, you just hear everything outside. So I apologise for my voice beforehand when we get to Tayport. And I'm struggling to speak. I've got someone who knows everything's happening at the show anyway next to me, so they'll be able to give you the rundown if I just mention, if I croak out the match that I've got written down. So we'll be fine. We'll be safe. We'll start with the first one because that's a good place to start. It is happening at the Tulloch Institute again in Perth. That is Friday the 18th of March. Fair City Wrestling returns to Perth. For those that are wanting to know how to get tickets, you can go to fcw.eventbrite.com.
That is it.
Yes.
That is it. And if anyone that's actually intrinsically involved or even follows us doesn't know that particular link by now, then they aren't a fan and they aren't intrinsically involved.
I think it was the last time you kind of drummed it into me when we were speaking about it, because I was like, eventbrite.com, fairs-city-wrestling, and... I could sense the rage going, no, we've got this, it's FCW. So yeah, 6:30 PM, doors open, bell time 7, you know, your typical kind of opening times for a show, and this is pretty packed. So this is your first event for the week, for the weekend coming. Do you know, as people be contacted, do you know anyone who's going to try go for the triple? Who's going for the trifecta?
Trifecta?
Trifecta shows.
Well, who's going to be there?
No, as in, I didn't even want to contact you, fans, or
who's going to be for all three?
Yeah.
Off the top of my head, I think there might be a certain someone who enjoys a tag team that we can't talk about anymore. I think that particular person might be at all three. But you know, if anyone is at all three, please make themselves known, because that's dedication.
That's the hardcore. It's the hardcore Fair City Wrestling fans. Yeah. Not that if you don't go to all three, you're not a hardcore fan. Because
not at all.
Dig him a hole here. Let's just get a ladder and climb stuff out. Anyway, let's dive into the show then, because there's six matches on the Perth event, and then we'll get to the rest of them. So where will we start? Let's go for the big heavyweight match to start off with. Yes. So we've got Asylum against Nathan Reynolds. So both these guys are coming, their last appearances in FCW, I think, were in championship matches, which were unsuccessful. Yes. And now they're just going to batter each other in Perth instead. So, yeah, putting together a heavyweight contest. Yeah. What's your kind of thought process for these kind of things?
Have you ever seen Street Fighter, the movie?
A very long time ago, but yes.
A long time ago. It's one of the best movie adaptations of a video game ever, because it's so awful that it's amazing. I suggest you watch it again, because it will just tickle your pink. But there is a scene where the rest of the guys are watching E Honda and Zangief battle on Bison's model of his world domination, and it's pretty much a parody of King Kong versus Godzilla. That's this match. That's entirely this match. Ever since hold on, 2 seconds, my laptop wants to schedule a hardware scan, which is not happening, laptop. You're going to do that in 4 hours when I'm switched you off. Anyway, ever since I laid eyes on Asylum, obviously Nathan Reynolds is, you know, very familiar to me. I know him inside and out. I also know who would give him a challenge. I also know who would, you know, get the best out of the one to watch. I mean, we all know he went to war with Abyss back when. And ever since I laid eyes on Asylum, I was like, I want to throw you at Nate and see what he does. That is me basically just standing up in an ivory tower saying, let them fight. And you know, like, I genuinely cannot wait for this, and I hope the ring can survive it as well.
Asylum, I haven't actually seen Asylum wrestle. I think you may have heard some bits on YouTube, of course. Everyone has at some point.
This was my last match. He's been my last match. I've not wrestled since then.
That was plenty for you. Once you had Asylum, you're like, that's okay, I'm all right.
Yeah.
I've completed wrestling. Yes. That'll do me. Nathan Reynolds, like you say, very familiar with him. I think the last time I saw Nathan wrestle live, he was against Tormentor, so obviously wasn't there for long. Wasn't getting paid by them.
That might have just been a dream come true for the one to watch as well.
Well, I mean, he didn't even take off his jacket. that was how quick it was. It was a nice jacket, though, to be fair. So this is your King Kong Godzilla match. If you're going down to Perth, this is what you're going to see. Asylum, of course, like, he will be the last time we mention him on this particular show. He's got a very different match next that we'll speak about when we get to Dundee. A big colossus, two guys just gonna absolutely
colossi.
This is your big beefy match, big man slapping meat, etc. Shout out to Biggie, like, he'll listen to this. Yes. So next up, we've got Liston Ross and Tommy Cross. Now,
yes,
there's a good part of me, there's a very large part of my brain going, you booked this because it rhymed.
Oh no, Billy's on to me. You know what? Yeah, you're wrong, but it's a happy accident. I seen these two actually face off in Arcadian. Arcadian had a rumble the last time I visited, and I got to see these two actually very physically square off in the middle of this rumble, and I instantly thought, well, here's a match I have to book. The pair of them have very different qualities that for the very brief interaction they had in this rumble, I could instantly see this is a match waiting to happen. So and their names rhyme.
So Tommy Cross, of course, familiar with the Fair City crowd, because he's part of Red Gate. He's been around since pretty much the inception of Fair City pre-pandemic, as well. Liston Ross, though, like I say, down in Arcadian, is that where his kind of home promotion lies? I don't know.
I think it's the general northeast of England scene. He's very intrinsically involved in. I do see a lot of his stuff and. I forget the name, but it's a quite a well equipped gym where the betraying takes place. I think it's, oh, I forget his name. That's the primate who trains guys down there as well as other people. And you know, I do. I keep my eye on where people are and who they train with and where they train and how they train and stuff like that. So yeah, Liston's a very welcome addition to the roster, and I'm very much looking forward to seeing if Cross can beat Ross.
So yeah, Liston being a guy, you'd say primate, so of course I think he was in NXT UK for a bit as well, Jason Prime.
Yep. Yep.
So yeah, that's pretty decent kind of background. As someone who like yourself, we've toured like the Northeast as well in your travels over the years. Is that when they bring in the local talent to be on these shows, it always in the back of your mind, do you remember, oh, I remember when I was in Stockton that I saw this guy, and you mental notes to go, if I'm booking a show, I need to get this guy on. Is that kind of how it's worked for some of these guys?
It's all I do. Like, I feel that, you know, when people travel around, especially people who have the pencil, I think it's worthwhile to keep mental note of who you would like to see wrestle your guys, who you'd like the fans to see. Because everyone that does that travels in, that comes from other places, it's a breath of fresh air, I think. So so yeah, I'm definitely one of those that do, if I'm at a show, either just by happenstance, or if I'm working a show and I'm backstage with people, I'll definitely keep an eye out for who would be good for not only the card but for backstage as well. I'll look out for people who would give a measure of care about the product that I'm putting on. So,
So speaking of that, then, of guys that you've brought in that bring a bit of a fresh flavor, I will go for the tag team match. Then we've got Botchko and Spike Tierney. Spike, of course, recently just making his return to Fair City after an extended absence, taking on just one of my favourite teams, of course, up in the Northeast here, Foundation of the Future, Zach Dynamite and Ryan Riley.
Yep.
So many people were saying that the Foundation of the Future match
Nathan North and Duke Cannon.
Thank you. Apologies to Nathan and Duke. I had Nathan in my head. I was going, I can't remember your surname. Nathan North and Duke Cannon. I'm saying that it was like the best match on the previous Fair City show that they were on.
I would agree with that. I would definitely agree with that, because obviously I did the color commentary for that, if you've seen that on our YouTube channel. And just watching these guys just put it all out there, almost to prove a point. They definitely impressed me, especially like all the guys in that match impressed me, but the Foundation definitely impressed me enough for me to be like, right, okay, let's get you back. Let's put you in with a very different team. that was the start of me thinking, right, I'm going to cultivate a pretty competitive, different tag team division. You say that the Foundation of the Future is like your favorite tag team, they're slowly becoming my favorite tag team as well.
Absolutely. I watched the match, of course, because you put it on YouTube, put the full show on YouTube, and I really liked it. I put it out there in the review, it was probably my second favorite match tonight. The Omar Kincaid one just pipped it for me, personally. But as soon as I put that out, I had Omar contact me going, no, you're wrong, the Foundation match is better. And I went, no. They were both good, don't get me wrong, but your one just tipped it for me. But this is just an absolute great team, really well worked unit, and now the people in Fair City are saying what I've been saying for however long up in my little cubby hole up in the Northeast, going, these guys are good, people should need to see these guys. And they're getting to see them now. These guys have got a busy weekend ahead. They've got this, and then they've got, I think they've got a Rumble on Saturday as well. Yeah. Elsewhere, they've got a fair busy weekend. I mean, not as busy, of course, three shows in a row, but still pretty busy.
Yeah, no, like again, those guys again, they're really great to work with, and they definitely deserve to be as many places as possible. So, they're kicking their weekend off well.
I'm not going to discount the team, of course, Butch Coat and Spike Tierney. So
we're definitely not. We're definitely not.
So Spike, of course, is a very fast luchador. He's quite deceptive. Like, you wouldn't think for looking at him that he'd be as fast as he is, if you know what I mean. He's a bit,
yeah,
bit shorter and what have you. But he's really, really good from what I remember seeing of him. Butch Coat, it was a different experience for me. So the first time I seen him was that show that he uploaded recently against Yunji Maki, Captain Maki. And you know what? I came in thinking this might be too far on the side of silly for me. And I like silly. I love silly. I love Bulgarian Baker. So I love silly stuff. But slowly that this match went on, I was like, all right, okay. I quite like this. This is a bit different. This is using ineptitude to the advantage kind of thing. It's like, oh, it's just, yeah, it was a great, good, bloody match. That's what it was with him and Maki.
Yeah, yeah. As I say, like the very kind words that you wrote about Mr. Butchko, like he definitely read them and he appreciated it. Because when I was doing color commentary, and he made his entrance, it was what did I say? I think it was I'm very surprised he's still on 2 feet. And the second I said it, he wasn't on 2 feet. But you know, like the team of Spike Tierney and Bochico, it makes sense, but it shouldn't make sense. You know, you've got someone who's a very capable luchador. And you know, has all the fire and fight in the world, and then you've got someone who has an equal amount of fire and fight. You've seen all the kind of the offense that Ewan Mackie gave to him, but you know, the like has pure. I don't know how to describe it.
It's just a happenstance that he ends up
yes,
in.
It's like Jar Jar Binks in a mask. that's almost like the perfect analogy for our Bochico. I don't know if you caught Spike trying to kind of train him, trying to kind of tighten these things up when we put our little. I think it was like the other day that we posted that little bit of their training session. I don't know if you've seen it.
I don't think I have. I'm very well behind on everything at the moment.
You know, he was trying his best, but you know, Bochico, like the biggest thing I'll say about Bochico is he's accident prone, but he means well. But again, those two realize that there is a tag team division being coined out. And as much as the Foundation of the Future have an L to their name, they're definitely not the underdogs. Our resident luchadors are. But at the same time, there are certainly tricks that the Spike and Bochico have, especially Spike, that the Foundation might not be ready for. So, you know, it's anyone's game to really call in terms of where the tag team division's going. So again, I say this every time, but it's another one I'm looking forward to. Of course, I'm looking forward to all of them because I put them together. So, but you know, like I say all the time, tag team wrestling is something that means a hell of a lot to me. And the more tag teams that I can give opportunities to shine and to make their way in the ranks, you know, I'm definitely all for it.
Absolutely, it's really starting to build as well. Because of course you got Cannon North, you've got Redgate, you've got the Foundation, you've got Butchko and Spike Tierney. There's a litany of guys. You've got of course the Glory Hunter as well. So you've got plenty of stuff that's simmering in a tag team division, just about ready to I don't know.
We lost the tag team due to recent events, which upsets me greatly. We can't talk about it.
That's fine. Okay, I was about to go, I don't remember it. Do I? And then I just said, let's just move on. Let's go. let's just move on from there. So yeah, there's a lot of I remember now. Right, okay, so we'll just go. So Captain Mackey's Golden Treasure Invitational. That's a good way to kind of absolutely bomb into a segue. So we've got Captain Yuji Maki taking on Thaddeus Vogue. So I think he was at one of the previous shows, wasn't he, Thaddeus? Again,
yeah, he was at the last Bonner Hall show. And he was, what was he doing? Thaddeus Vogue was tagging with Zach Leon, RIP Zach. He's not dead, he's just not wrestling anymore. against Ewan and Mr. Ryan Rude. And that match was just, oh, I don't know if you've seen it. I don't know, it's definitely online. But, you know, any match that ends with a dance-off is fine with me.
Writing that but, down now to watch later. There we yeah. go.
But, you know, the last person to take up the challenge of the Invitational, Mr. Tom Atlas, fresh from the FCW Training Centre, that was a good outing for Mr. Atlas, and it was a decent threat to what is now, I think it's a 9-0 winning streak. So there's more than just, you know, Mr. Mackey's booty on the line. But you know, Thaddeus Vogue definitely had Ewan's number a fair few times in that tag match, so it just made sense to, you know, I'm going to fire as many people at this Invitational until such time as someone else is in possession of his gold,
his jewels, ill-gotten gold,
ill-gotten gold. But yeah, and again, like the Thaddeus Vogue is definitely someone who probably wouldn't be that fazed by a lot of Ewan's antics. So it's definitely someone that I think has a real chance to dethrone the Goblin of the Seas.
Now, so because he's got his Invitational on the first night, and there's two more nights of one night and an afternoon of Fair City Wrestling to come, is this kind of if Maki continues to hold on to his booty from the first night, are we likely to see him pop up again on Saturday and Sunday to
more than likely we haven't discussed anything else, purely because he only wants to speak via written letter that are sent by Seagull or Pigeon. So he may very well just pop up and chatting and throughout the challenge himself if it's still going. But you know, the captain is never far away at an FCW show.
So of course Thaddeus Vogue, just one last thing, because he's not a name that you said he was at the last Bonner show, but he's a name that's maybe not familiar for a lot of people. Again, so again, was this an Arcanian find while you were taking your trip?
Yeah, definitely. Again, I've watched him, Thaddeus Vogue, for a while. Like he worked for, I think it was Rad Pro, Hybrid, back in the day, and he's been around for a while as well. And again, to allow people to be able to travel, to be able to be in front of new crowds, to give our crowds someone new to look at, someone different. It's definitely all part of what FCW is about. So he was definitely someone that was on my list to bring up again and bring up initially in November.
So we've got two championship matches then to round off the first night of our triple header madness.
Yep.
Triple header. We've got the FCW Junior Heavyweight Championship online, where we've got Taylor Bryden defending against Sebastian Asher with Marcus Hunter at ringside. So at the last show, of course, we've got Taylor Bryden dethroned Ken Caden in what, by all accounts, is an incredible match from what I've been hearing. So Taylor Bryden, someone you have a lot of history with, that you've known him since around about the start of his journey.
Since almost my first bump.
And he's coming in. How are you feeling when you saw him get that championship win against Ken Caden?
I mean, like Taylor Bryden's always been like the poster child of what a capable wrestler is supposed to act like in the ring and look like in the ring. But obviously, this you know, you want to see the start of when we came back after the pandemic. Taylor just arrived looking like that times 10. And for as long as I've known Taylor Bryden, he it's not like he's not had a fair shake of the stick, and it's not like anyone's put him to the side or he's been an afterthought. But I just feel that he's never been in positions to really prove himself to a wider audience, to an audience that would believably think that he's the man to be leading a division. And, you know, when he came back, as good and as integral as our first champion King Caden was, and as much as he was a stand-up champion, you know, I know the division's now in not better hands, but like it's progressing into someone who's still going to take care of the division. And I know he's just going to be a fighting champion. I know he's going to take on all comers. He's going to take on contenders that are going to push him to his limits. And you know, it was a good sight. It was a good like the him posting about it the next day, and then obviously I can't remember when it was, but he's also the Reckless Intent. Is it the UK champion?
Yes, yeah, UK champion.
And that just solidifies where Taylor is, because you know he should be a walking belt rack as far as I'm concerned. Yeah, so I'm fairly happy for him, and I'm more ecstatic for FCW, because it only helps FCW having a champion of that caliber.
So he's coming against Sebastian Asher of was it Gloria Hunter?
Glory Hunter agencies.
He
changes it all the time. You might be one of those people that changes their company on company's house every now and again just to avoid the tax man.
As someone who works in insurance, that is not the last thing, not the first time I would have heard or seen that. So that's not surprising me. So Sebastian Asher then, hasn't been in the ring too many times, but he seems to be. He somehow found his way into a championship match himself.
Mark the Glory Hunter, as he prefers to be fully named. 2 seconds. I'm so ill, Billy. I'm so ill. Anyway, he literally phoned me 53 times. 53 times. So like I think Sami Zayn is currently being hounded on the phone, and I don't think it's pretty similar. Like, he wouldn't leave me alone. We had an initial discussion about him being the first, Sebastian being the first to take on Taylor Bryden, and I said I would think about it. Most of the time when I say I think about it, I won't think about it. I've got other things to think about. But I couldn't sleep. I'm pretty sure he followed me while I was out and about. So I think I had to just give in. Now, in terms of Sebastian Asher, he's definitely something that probably would receive a junior heavyweight title match eventually. He's fresh out of the FCW training centre as well. But, you know, Sebastian's fully capable. He's got every single tool available to him to be one of the best in FCW and one of the best in Scotland. He just happens to have an ambulance chaser or a manager just now, which is, you know, it's to his credit. To his credit, he's got a title match. He's in the position that, you know, his manager wanted him in. But again, I don't think that's going to hinder the match. I think the match itself is going to be really good. I think that Taylor Bryden's going to look at who's in front of him and not who's outside the ring, and go through him like a fart through a colander. So, I'm looking forward to it.
So I mean, you could say that Sebastian Asher has all the tools, but the biggest tool he has is Marcus the Glory Hunter.
Oh, he's definitely a big tool, so that's, yeah.
So yeah, Taylor Bryan, of course, when he was going before the match happened, they had the big build up, the promo that he called out King Kaden on. Yeah, when you're saying that, yeah, he's looking at his opponent, not past it. I think he's just, I get the vibe that Taylor's thankful for each moment. You know, he's got the belt right now. Next defense, he's got to do that, and then the next defense, he'll think about that once he's got past the next.
Yeah, I've always said for any championship I've had, for any championship that I've had the pleasure of calling, I've always said that, you know, the second the champion hands that title over to the referee before the bell's rung, he's lost it. He doesn't have it. He's got to fight to get that back in his hands. That's what a fighting champion does, and that's entirely what Taylor Bryden is. So, yeah.
And then finally, we've got our main event of the first night in Perth. We've got FCW Heavyweight Championship. We've got Caleb Valhalla, the mighty, the Norse god, the big sexy Caleb, as we like to call him, up here. Caleb Valhalla taking on Ryan Roode. So Ryan Roode, again, you mentioned him earlier through the Thaddeus Fogg discussion. So, yeah, it was just a no-brainer to bring Ryan back up after his performance at Bonner Hall.
I can't even remember if I said this the last time I was on, but if I could have Ryan Roode on every single show, I absolutely would. The man just brings something completely unique to shows, and to put him against the top of the tree was also a no-brainer. But it's also something that, again, it's the Kev cliche of these. I can't wait for this match. I really can't. to have someone with the power and pedigree of Valhalla against someone with just, you know, sheer unpredictability of Ryan Roode. It's like you say, it was a complete no-brainer to put on.
Valhalla's reign, he's still against big guys. Big in one way or another. So
yeah,
likes of Asylum already, Divers and
Andy Wild,
Ian Ambrose as well.
Yeah.
So he's fair racking up the defenses against just hard hitting opponents just big dudes. Oh, Luke King Sharp as well, the biggest man in pro wrestling. If he steps on his little black book of contacts, he's probably taller than most of us. This is the main event again. Caleb Valhalla defending the championship against another tough opponent. It's what more can you say about Caleb Valhalla that hasn't already been said in either our discussions that have went out into the internet, into web, or what I say most months when I end up in Aberdeen and go, this guy is just amazing. Everyone needs to see Caleb Valhalla.
Like the Caleb Valhalla, it's not a hype train, it's a hype log ship that's just a long boat that's just barreling through Scottish wrestling just now. And for him to be our champion, I've said it before he came on board, and I'll say it now, it's something that, you know, we feel very, very honoured that he's a part of the roster, and he's just been an exemplary champion thus far.
So that's the first night. As we're both a picture of health at the moment, with both of our throats kind of giving up the ghost, we're gonna rattle into the second night and then get into Tayport as well. So I will just list off the matches that we've just discussed. If you want to rewind back and get any of them, give you all the details, how to get tickets, etc., and then we'll go up into Dundee. So match announced: Asylum against Nathan Reynolds, your big beefy match. You got Liston Ross against Tommy Cross, not because it rhymed, because it was a great interaction at a previous show that needed to be put into action. We've got Botchko and Spike Tierney against the Foundation of the Future, Zach Dynamite and Ryan Riley, which is one I'm certainly looking out for, because Dynamite and Riley are just not very happy people, and I don't know how they're going to react to Botchko in general. It might be a very long night for Botchko. We've got Captain Ewan G. Mackey. He's got his booty, his Golden Treasure Invitational on the line against Thaddeus Fogg. FCW Junior Heavyweight Championship, Taylor Bryden defends against Sebastian
Asher.
My apologies, Sebastian. Speaking of that, Marcus Hunter will be at ringside. The FCW Heavyweight Championship, Caleb Valhalla against Ryan Roode, with Valhalla defending. More information.
What a night. What a first night.
I know. How are you going to top that?
I know.
And we're going to get onto that in a second. So doors open 6:30, bell time 7, fcw.eventbrite.com for all your tickets if you want to get to the show. Right. A little breather. I don't even tell anyone. It's Tillich Institute in Perth. I said that at the start, but just so you know where you're going, Friday the 18th of March, Tillich Institute in Perth, Fair City Wrestling's hometown, home base of
home operations. Home base. Our home.
We're going right into 19th of March, Saturday at the Bonner Hall in Dundee. The last time you were there, the show was so hot that the Fire Brigade were involved. So, you know, you've got to have a show to top that. And looking at the matches that have been announced already, I mean, you're going to have a pretty good go of it. You're going to have a good chance of blowing the roof off again. And who knows what will happen. Fingers crossed, less drama outside the ring, but maybe a little bit more inside. 6:30 p.m., 6:30 doors open, 7 p.m. bell time again, fcw.eventbrite.com. Yep. Bonner Hall, a great venue. I love the setup of it. I love the kind of... And this is going to be hyperbolic when I mention it, but it's like remember like 2000 when they set up the Madison Square Garden and they'd have the entranceway and they'd have the car on top and all that kind of stuff for Royal Rumble. That's my previous trips to the Bonner Hall. That's all I thought about as soon as
that's entirely how I feel about the Bonner Hall as well. But it's a beautiful building.
So we've got four batches announced according to my information here. I'm assuming there may be more announced before Saturday, maybe some fallout of Friday. We don't know. We'll find out. So we're going to start off with a match that I actually saw a promo for this morning about, which is Brody Adler against Cassie King. So yes. Brody's coming into this just being thrown right to the back of the line when it comes to the SW Women's Championship due to shenanigans. Thanks to tag team that we can't mention anymore, but I've remembered who they are since we now remember who they are, which is very unfortunate. I don't know, maybe if they switch their allegiance we can see them again, who knows. Brody Hadler is annoyed, pissed off, and I've seen her be this happy-go-lucky Brody Hadler, and I'm kind of fear for the debuting Cassie King when she's coming to this one, but Cassie King's quite spooky, so this could be a bit of a weird one. This could be a bit of a
I mean, like Brody's got every reason to feel the way she does, and you know, I feel a little guilty because, you know, it's my show, it's my deal, and more than once, and we'll get into this when we talk about the main event, more than once she's been the victim and all of the shenanigans, but you know, if I lay something out, I typically have to, you know, follow through with it. So she is unfortunately having to go to the back of the queue, but you know, in terms of where I see her going, I think it all depends on Brody. You know, disappointment and you know, ill feelings can either make or break you. So it's really on her shoulders to really get back where she wants to be. And in terms of who she's going against, she's got someone that she probably knows quite well. So but that's an advantage for both ladies as far as I'm concerned. But they're both in the same position. They're both starting at the bottom of the ladder. It's Cassie King's debut. So she doesn't have anything to go off previously. She doesn't have any excuses or not excuses. She doesn't have any gripes or complaints about what's happened before. She's probably looking at what's in front of her. So so I'm excited for it. I really think that, you know, it's another way to ensure that, you know, the women's division is in good hands. But you know, you've got to fight for it. You've got to earn it.
Yeah, so Cassie's coming in. Cassie and Brody, of course, they do have a little bit of a history. They've trained together. They were supposed to debut around about the same time, but of course that damn corona and not the beer hit, and it just wasn't to be. But Cassie, I've seen her wrestle. She's this deceptively scrappy. She'll get her body part and just kind of just not let go kind of thing. Yeah. I think there's a match with Ronnie Knox is what I saw her in at Renegade, and yeah, she's got something about her. I'm interested to see how she grows, and like you're saying, she's come into this with absolutely nothing to lose, nothing at all. Whereas Brody, she's already at the back of the line, so if she loses, she's still rooted to the back. So she needs to kind of move her way forward. So I think this is going to be quite a bit of an emotional match, possibly. If Brody's in the right mindset, it could just be a pure masker. We don't know. That's the thing with this match. It's just anything could happen.
Yeah, I agree. It's very unpredictable, and that's how I like it.
That's the best way. I mean, coming into wrestling shows, as long as we've watched it, you're a little bit longer for yourself, but as long as we've been watching these shows, when you come to a show and you don't know anything that's happening, or if you think it's going to happen and it doesn't, it just makes for a better show. And every single time, there's no exception to that rule. Sometimes I'm like, this person has to win, otherwise I'm going to cry. But no, that's a different story for a different time. So we've got that match. And speaking of, could be a massacre, we're back with Asylum. And as we mentioned already, looking sharp with his little black book, who makes him probably taller than Asylum. But Asylum versus Looking Sharp. Now, people are going to look at this and go, is Looking Sharp? He's 5'4". I think he's a bit more than what he was back in the day when I saw him start out. But he doesn't matter who you're against, he will take you if he so wishes. And these guys have had a little bit of a run-in before in FCW.
Yeah, yeah. You know, like, some people might look at like, not knowing anything, not knowing the context, not knowing anything, might look at that and be like, oh God, what a mismatch that is. Not in the slightest. You can't look at someone like Looking Sharp and think that putting him against someone like Asylum is any kind of mismatch. The last time he was at the Bonner Hall, the last time he was on an FCW show, he did literally stand on the shoulders of giants and kept our fans entertained while we dealt with certain things going on, and definitely made himself an asset to FCW and to myself. So but they did him and Asylum definitely crossed paths in that main event that night. So I thought, why not just let them fight? Like, it's a David versus Goliath, but which one's David and which one's Goliath is the question, really. I don't think Asylum's actually prepared for a focused Looking Sharp coming at him. Just him, not anyone else in the match. It's interesting, and I like interesting.
Definitely. He's a bit like a Jack Russell is Looking Sharp. He'll just keep coming at you until somehow you're able to shake them off. Looking Sharp at the moment, he's again still world traveled. He's quite heavily involved in CCW in Copenhagen as well. So I mean, not that this is important to the show in general, but when you got guys on the show looking to maybe branch out and try and get into Europe, and that having Looking Sharp on the show automatically makes everyone step their game up a little bit as well. Because if you impress Looking Sharp, then you never know. You might have to get the old passport renewed and head your way to the Scandinavian countries as well. So, this is going to be definitely interesting. It's not you can't write out Looking Sharp, especially just because it's Looking Sharp. But I think, like we're saying with the first match, it's interesting, could be emotional. I think this is just going to be Sayre for somebody. I honestly don't know who for. Who's going to walk out the sorest after this?
Yeah, that's entirely what I think as well. So yeah, looking forward to that one.
My throat's going. Yeah, we are. This is the sick cast. If we're gonna do it, by the time we get to Tayport, we'll just be
I've got an inhaler here. Let's just break that out.
So yeah, by the time we get to Tayport, we'll just be holding up signs, so it'll be very useless for an audio medium podcast. So this third match we've got here is Ryan Reed back after, I mean, this possibly could be for the FCW Heavyweight Championship.
Absolutely. This could be an advantageous match for the person he's taking on.
Which is the Batfamous Ian Batfamous, Ambrose.
The Batfamous Ian Ambrose, which is a play on the fact that he is the infamous Ian Ambrose, and he's probably been to see the Batman more than once.
I haven't seen it as yet. I haven't had the time or energy to go, so I haven't seen it. So no spoilers.
Ian Ambrose is someone who's very synonymous with the Bonner Hall. And you know, he made his presence felt the last time we were there. He challenged the Valhalla. He came up slightly short when he actually got round to doing that, which is something that he's been pretty sore about. But you know, I do genuinely believe that him wanting to defend the city of Dundee and defend the Bonner Hall isn't just delirium from going to see a superhero movie. I genuinely think that he wants to defend somewhere where he's had some of the best matches of his career, on a completely new, fresh landscape, will go against someone who is probably just as unpredictable as he is. And like you say, this could be a very advantageous night for the Batfamous if Ryan Rood has a very nice shiny red belt around his waist. People need to either keep an eye on what's going on in Perth on Friday night, or just come along and find out themselves. But as I say, like the pairing of Ryan Rood and infamous Ian Ambrose, just anything can happen in this match. Anything. Kev's cliche, I'm looking forward to this match. I'll put my stamp on this now. I'm looking forward to this match probably more than any other match on the card, really. It's Ryan Reed versus Ian Ambrose.
But yeah, you're saying about Ian, of course, yeah, like you're saying, he's faced likes of Joe Hendry, Big Damo, Chris Hero. His work in Dundee is sublime, and unfortunately, because of circumstances and that, he has kind of put that on the back burner and start afresh and try and make new big moments and new memories that he can share and put out there. So yeah, the fact that he could, by some sort of circumstance, happenstance, excuse my buzzword for this, happenstance, that he could end up coming to the show just thinking he's going to face Ryan Rood and be prepared for that, but the events of Perth the night before means that he could be in a championship match again with just out of nowhere. What do you think of Scully?
I think that Scully, if he were to break out the wrestling rule book, he does count as a foreign object. So, his involvement in certain matches is something that I'm not entirely pleased about, but he's also not done a hell of a lot in these matches. I think he came off more injured than any of the other two in the match he was in. He broke his jaw. And this is what I said on the actual show, that Ian Ambrose is just such a weird dude, and for him to bring along Scully, and Scully seems to have almost taken over Ian Ambrose. It's the thing is, and you might enjoy it, but like, Ryan Rood's not one to shy away from probably putting him down his pants if Scully gets out of line. So, you know, that could very well happen if Scully decides that he's going to get involved. He's a weird dude. He's a weird dude. And Ian Ambrose isn't any better.
I'm assuming that Ian's already made several contacts about you getting his manager's license and what have you for Scully. But
I've yet to see that paperwork.
Yeah. I'm sure. I mean, you know the what the councils are like. It could be.
Yeah.
it'll be hanging about there somewhere.
Red tape.
We've got the main event, of course, announced of the four matches we have on the show, being the FCW Women's Championship.
Yes.
Serena Rose defends the title against just one of the best wrestlers in easily the, probably the UK right now, in Lana Austin.
Yep.
So how important was it for you to get hold of Lana Austin, because I know she's very busy, and get her on the show?
Yeah. Well, you know, like I said before, when we were talking about Brody, like the Women's Championship has had a fairly dramatic story already, when, you know, it was Brody versus Serena, and you know, I would have been I would have been happy either way, whoever took it, but I never thought that Serena would duck out of as many challenges and defenses as she has. You know, she ducked out of her first defense against Debbie Dahmer, and that just set alarm bells for the division. Like, I want to protect all the divisions and make sure that the champions are in place that are going to, you know, do the best for them. So when that alarm bell went off, I was like, right, okay, who's someone that she can't duck out on? She can't. There's no one in their right mind who would turn down or duck out of a match with Lana Austin. I think everyone's probably seen a lot of the body of her work. You know, there's so much that she brings to the table. I'm a very big fan of her head scissors stunner. I think it's amazing. So inventive. But you know, that's kind of what led me to, you know, put Lana Austin in the position that she's in. And the mere fact that, you know, we've managed to secure her coming up is, you know, it's a big coup, and it's one of the biggest gets that I've got since we've started. Obviously we had Andy Wilde, who's obviously had NXT UK success, and Lana Austin is no different. So that's just a massive treat for the fans. They get to see people that they can go and watch on TV and stuff like that. So that's, you know, it's grand. So, you know, I don't want to be biased here. I don't want to, you know, play my cards too early, but I genuinely hope that we have a new women's champion by the time that we leave the Bonner Hall, because Serena has shown herself to not be really, she's using it more as a fashion accessory than it is, you know, a women's championship, and that doesn't sit well with me at all. And the fact that it's no DQ, that, you know, that was a decision that I made to make sure that, you know, if anything does attempt to go down, then there's that safety buffer of it being no DQ, and Lana can do whatever she wants to whoever she wants. So, you know, it's all to play for in our main event. So yeah.
So yeah, like you're saying, so because it's in Cirque du Litt's best interest to be in the ring with Lana Austin, because that's the most high profile match that can happen. What I'm very interested in then is no DQ, which I missed in the announcements. So there's another mark against my professionalism. So Serena Rose, of course, will have Brandi Max skulking about somewhere, and this whole thing. The fact that Brody and Cassie King are in that match earlier in the show, I've got to think no DQ, if Brody does or doesn't get the outcome she wants in her match with Cassie King, I've got a feeling Brody might have something to neutralize Brandi.
Yeah. I think any women in the division who are around during that match would be very remiss in their duties and not keeping an eye on what's going on. So, yeah, you're right. There might be certain people making their presence known during that match, and it would be completely legal because it's no DQ.
So, I mean, we're looking at a show, these two shows that we've got, because next one we've got like one match and a plus. That's right. That's all we've got. Yeah. So we'll get to that in a minute. But we're going to the shows we've got. Like you're saying, the people you see on TV, because you've got the likes of Kayla Valhalla being on the WWE Network, And then you've got on this show, you've got Looking Sharp as well. We've got Lana Austin on Progress. So this is pretty much your chance. If you might not get a chance to see some of these guys again live. Possibly because NXT UK could snap up Lana Austin just like that, and then that'll be her kind of back on the telly, but you might not get to see her live unless you go to NXT UK. So if there's a way to sell just any, if they're like a niggling feeling thinking maybe I shouldn't go to the show, this is the reason. These are your wrestlers of tomorrow. These are the guys that are going to be on. These are the guys you're going to be seeing with likes of Nikki Ash and Doudrop and Kaylee Ray and Drew and all these Scottish guys and girls that are now on the big TV. You can get to see them at this level and before they get snapped up. You said it's the match that you're kind of looking forward to the most as a in-ring prospect, Ryan Roode and Ian Ambrose. Assuming that as their promoter hat on, they got Man with the Pencil hat, the main event's one you're going to be kind of...
I definitely think the main event's going to be very, very good for business. Win, lose, you know, try not to be biased here, but I am. Again, it's very important to us that, you know, we're back in Dundee, we're back at the Bonner Hall, we're not going anywhere. We have a loyal fan base who are absolutely itching for some FCW on Saturday night.
So to recap, then, doors open 6:30 p.m. Bell time 7 p.m. Available tickets are available fcw.eventbrite.com. You know, I've said that many times now, it's just rolling off the tongue quite nicely. Saturday, 19th of March at the Bonner Hall in Dundee. You can't miss it. It's so easy to find. Ridiculously easy. If you get off the train, you're probably about a 5 minute walk. 10 minute walk there. No bother. You'll be fine. Brody Adler against Cassie King. Asylum against Luke King Sharp. Ryan Roode against Ian Ambrose with Scully, possibly for the title. We don't know. We'll have to find out from Friday. And SW Women's Championship is on the line when Cena Rose finally defends, and she'll be taking on Lana Austin one-on-one. So, yeah, and this might not be the complete card, but it's still a packed show that people in Dundee are going to get for their money on a Saturday night. What's not to love?
What isn't to love?
And as we both still have our voices, we're going to wrap up with the Tayport event, which takes place on Sunday, the 20th of March at the Larick Centre in Tayport. Doors open 2:30 p.m. and bell time 3 p.m. fcw.eventbrite.com for tickets. I love an afternoon show mainly because I just like to have my wrestling done and then I can just go home, have a nap. Evenings, you kind of have to do a bit more planning for an evening show in my head anyway. But one match announced, we'll go for the plus first. So Luke Matthews is making his Fair City Wrestling debut. He took exception to being called the young up-and-comer, though.
I didn't say young. I said up-and-coming. And what we meant by that is, you know, he's maybe been doing it for X amount of years. Minus two. Everyone needs the minus two a year. But, you know, as far as I'm aware, this is his first outing outside of Glasgow. I like to think anyone that's making their debut for us is up and coming. They're getting out there in front of our fans, who are the best fans in the world, and they're getting in front of, you know, our roster, who, you know, will bring the very best out of them. So that's what I meant by up and coming. But, you know, obviously that's, you know, got these knickers in twist, which is fine. If you're annoyed, use that. And, like, you know, like, to finish off what your point probably was, he's called out the best. He's called out any champion. He's called out anyone from the training centre. He's called out the bloody ring announcer. I'm listening to that. So who he'll take on is going to be a very interesting night for Luke Matthews' debut.
You know, I mean, if anything, he's kind of put himself into a corner now where he's called out everyone and he's put it at the mercy of of the guy who wrote the post. So it could be a very, very, it could be advantageous night. You could come in, be a champion. You could walk out a champion. Who knows? Or you could have, you called it everyone. You could throw out, I don't know, you could throw out Asylum and Nathan Reynolds to him. You know, that's just,
One mind. That's exactly the two people I was thinking about. What would be the worst case scenario for him? Best case scenario for me. But you know, I do think a lot about Luke Matthews. No one that I put on a card, or no one that you'll see on any of our match graphics, or anyone that I don't respect to the highest regard. It's a great addition to the roster. It's a great addition for FCW as a whole. But you know, if we're going to be sensitive about Facebook posts, then you know, maybe you need to focus on, you know, what's going on between the ropes.
And speaking of between the ropes, then to kind of round off all the matches we've been talking about, because we've just got the one on this show announced. Of course, there will be more. I can safely assume. We've got a four-way elimination match. Love it. Four-way dance. Always good. We've got Thaddeus Vogue, Omar Muhammad, Tom Atlas, and is it Damian Valak?
Damian Nightstalker Valak.
Excellent. So four-way, we've already mentioned, we're talking about Thaddeus Vogue, if possible at length. He's going to have a very busy weekend of matches. We've got Tom Atlas, who we've mentioned already. He tried to take up Captain Yuji Maki. Oh, he did take up Yuji Maki's Golden Treasure Invitational, but was just short, shy on his goals. Damian Valak, not a name I'm totally familiar with. Again, is this an Arcadian find?
No, Damian Valak is actually one of our guys from the FCW Training Center. He made his debut at the last Tayport show in a tag team match. And, you know, all the guys that come through the door of our school, sometimes you just have to let them be themselves. And Damian, as anyone called Damian, like, you know, he's definitely a tortured soul, as you would like to call them. And you know, he definitely shows a lot of fire and fight. And you know, I thought that, you know, let's sit him amongst three other people. Why not?
And of course, can't not mention the Asian sensation himself, Omar Muhammad, rounding off this four way. This has got a little bit of everything, really, in a four way match. And from what I've understood of what you just described, Damian Valak, Thaddeus Vogue as well, he's a unique sort also. Tom Atlas, he's young, he's hungry, he can lift you and throw you. So, you know, not a bad combination to have. And then what can be said about Omar Muhammad, which hasn't already been said by me in several places. He's an Asian sensation. He is confident. He's cocky, perhaps, but he usually finds a way to at least... Yeah. Leave a mark. Might not be with the W, but certainly will leave an impression. So,
yes, indeed.
When you put this one together, was it just a case of you just want to see it? You just wanted to see these four individuals just kind of mix up?
I kind of felt that you know, after Tom Atlas's outing in the Invitational, Omar's outing in the junior heavyweight match with King Caden. Damian Valak's debut, as well as Thaddeus Vogue's efforts, I felt that, you know, a melding of all of these people, again, letting them fight to the last man. I think I'm going to definitely, for me, thinking about the future, we'll definitely see who wants something from FCW, be it, you know, a future title match, be it you know, being put in better positions and being kind of looked upon more favorably by myself and by the fans. So I love a good elimination match of any ratio. So I definitely think that everyone's got something to lose in this match, and they've got quite a lot to win as well.
I mean, you're saying that as well, because Discovery Wrestling often use this kind of format to kind of find contenders and find their next kind of guy as well. And more often than not, if you go back through the results, the winners of these four ways is the guys that are making up their roster that are still around. I mean, more recently, Kilo Valhalla being one of them, won a four-way elimination and is now... is now doing pretty well in Discovery, as well as being the champion. So
he's doing just a wee bit well.
He's doing okay.
He's doing alright.
He's fine. You can search him on the WWE Network, which is madness to me. But you know, he's doing okay. But you know, so these are always good ways to get in that clash of styles, see how people cope, see how people react, see how the fans react to them as well. Because you could win this four-way elimination, but if the crowd haven't taken to you or haven't reacted to you, then what was it for, kind of thing. So it's a good way for you to see what these guys have got. It's the old, you're the old Rick and Morty, massive golden head, going, show me what you got. And
show me what you got, yeah.
Just watching these guys do it.
Yeah, but again, like, you know, it's a fatal four-way elimination, and eliminations can happen fairly quickly. So, you know, you might not get the chance to make an impression on me or the fans. So, like, you know, people have to have the eyes in the back of their head for everyone in that match. So I feel especially bad for the referee in that match, to be perfectly honest.
Yeah, if you've got a couple of referees in hand, they'll all be rock, paper, scissors, trying not to be in this one. But no, I mean, that's what we've got for Tayport. So not much more we can say about that particular show. But again, it's all about the journey of the weekend. So
there might be some more announcements for Tayport coming up. But as I say, like the community of Tayport really came out in force for the last show, and it looks like they're going to do that again. I kind of want to leave them with some surprises. It's we're all going to be tired by this point, but we're going to be no less enthusiastic. I have no doubt that everyone involved on that night is going to completely kill it.
Fine, I'll leave it till Monday then before I pester you for results of all the shows. don't worry about it.
I'll keep notes after every show, and then I'll just copy and paste all the results to you.
Excellent. That's all. I like that kind of synergy. It's when I have to spend days trying to find one result. It's just a nightmare. Some companies are better than others, though. So to recap, then, we're not going to recap all the matches because we're not to spoil it too much, but we're getting quite late on tonight. And as an older gentleman, I like sleep in the next half an hour. So we will wrap up there. But so Fair City Wrestling coming to the Tulloch Institute in Perth on Friday the 18th of March, the Bonner Hall in Dundee on Saturday the 19th of March, and at the Larwick Centre in Tayport on Sunday the 20th of March. All tickets are available at fcw.eventbrite.com. Of all the matches, you've discussed which ones you're looking forward to seeing, ones more than others, but if there's one match over the course of this weekend that you're hoping there's memory card in the camera for that's going to go up on YouTube, which is the one you want people to see.
Yeah. The match that kind of encompasses the entire weekend. Let's just see how many people I'm going to offend by singling one match out.
If you want to throw a couple in there so you can offend less people, that's fine.
Definitely the tag match. Definitely the tag match on the Tulloch show, definitely that match, because again, I didn't go into the first tag match with the Foundation knowing a hell of a lot about them as a team. Like, I knew about them individually, but obviously was very aware of Nathan North and Duke Cannon, and like, as I say, both teams blew me away. But again, I was very impressed with the Foundation of the Future. But you know, I'm very excited to see how they handle Spike, Botchico, and Spike and Botchico, if that makes sense. They've got to deal with them as individuals as they are, but they also gel together quite well as a tag team, and I don't understand it why, but they do. And any match with Ryan Ridd any match with Ryan Reid, obviously as well as the champ, but you know, any match with Ryan Reid is a very special treat to have him for the entire weekend. So and the one thing I will say, if anyone's listening who hasn't been to an event, you know, this is the first time, as we've talked about, that it's the first time that we're doing Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and three completely different areas. But if you're on the fence about anyone at all, like, I would urge you just to get over that and just go to one, see how you like it. You know, like, it's something that we've all put, every single person that's involved in FCW, we've worked tirelessly. Look at the grey in this. Tirelessly to put on this weekend. It's the first big weekend that we've done. So, you know, if there's anyone listening to this who has an inkling that they might want to attend one of the events, please do. You will not regret it. fcw.eventbrite.com.
Excellent. And you can find out more at Fair City Res on Twitter and Fair City Wrestling on Facebook. And anything else, so if you've got any more match announcements, you can find them there. Or if you want to find out everything about Scottish wrestling in one place, it's swnscotland.com. And I will have them very quickly after they go up on the websites and that, with the actual links that kick back as well. So you still get all the hits, except you can all find them on my site. But no, I think we'll wrap up there. Go get some cough syrup. Go get some Alpol. And rest our throats for the rest of the weekend. But thank you very much for joining me again. Next time we do this, it'll be four shows, I'm sure. And then
no one.
by next year, you'll be doing a whole week of back to back shows, and you'll look like Santa Claus by that point.
Yes,
but
that's the goal.
But no, thank you very much for joining me again.
Yep.